principle, a metaphysical principle which he does not even attempt to formulate, which he vaguely describes as a motor rule of craft, and of which I have never seen any formulation which even looked promising and was not clearly untenable. But in fact the principles A to C do not clash. We can see this the moment we realize that the acceptance by science of a law or of a theory is tentative only, which is to say that all laws and theories are conjectures, are tentative hypotheses, a position which I have sometimes called hypotheticism, and that we may reject a law or theory on the basis of new evidence, without necessarily discarding the old evidence which originally led us to accept it. 20. The principle of empiricism C can be fully preserved, since the fate of a theory, its acceptance or rejection, is decided by observation and experiment, by the result of tests. So long as a theory stands up to the severest tests we can design, it is accepted. If it does not, it is rejected. But it is never inferred, in any sense, from the empirical evidence. There is neither a psychological nor blank. 19. Natural philosophy of cause and chance, p. 6. 20. I do not doubt that Bourne and many others would agree that theories are accepted only tentatively. But the widespread belief in induction shows that the far-reaching implications of this view are rarely seen. Minus 54. The logical induction, only the falsity of the theory can be inferred from empirical evidence, and this inference is a purely deductive one. Showed that it is not possible to infer a theory from observation statements, but this does not affect the possibility of refuting a theory by observation statements. The full appreciation of this possibility makes the relation between theories and observations perfectly clear. This solves the problem of the alleged clash between the principles A, B, and C, and with it Hume's problem of induction. X. Thus the problem of induction is solved. But nothing seems less wanted than a simple solution to an age-old philosophical problem. Wittgenstein and his school hold that genuine philosophical problems do not exist. 21. From which it clearly follows that they cannot be solved. Others among my contemporaries who believe that there are philosophical problems, and respect them, but they seem to respect them too much. They seem to believe that they are insoluble, if not taboo, and they are shocked and horrified by the claim that there is a simple, neat, and lucid solution to any of them. If there is a solution, it must be neat, they feel, or at least complicated. However this may be, I am still waiting for a simple, neat and lucid criticism of the solution which I published first in 1933 in my letter to the editor of Erkenntnis, 22 and later in the Logic of Scientific Discovery. Of course, one can invent new problems of induction, different from the one I have formulated and solved. Its formulation was half its solution. But I have yet to see any reformulation of the problem whose solution cannot be easily obtained from my old solution. I am now going to discuss some of these reformulations. One question which may be asked is this: how do we really jump from an observation statement to a theory? Although this question appears to be psychological rather than philosophical, one can say something positive about it without invoking psychology. One can say first that the jump is not from an observation statement, but from a problem situation, and that the theory must allow us to explain the observations which created the problem, that is, to determine deduce them from the theory strengthened by other accepted theories and by other observation statements, the so-called initial conditions. This leaves, of course, an immense number of possible theories, good and bad, and it thus appears that our question has not been answered. But this makes it fairly clear that when we ask our question, we have more in mind than, how do we jump from an observation statement to a theory? The question we had in mind was, it now appears, how do we jump from an observation statement to a new theory? But to this the answer is, by jumping first to any theory and then testing it, to find whether it is good or not, i.e., 21 Wittgenstein still held this belief in 1946. See note 8 to CH 2 below. 22 See note 5 above. Minus 55. By repeatedly applying the critical method, eliminating many bad theories, and inventing many new ones. Not everybody is able to do this, but there is no other way. Other questions have sometimes been asked. The original problem of induction, it was said, is the problem of justifying induction, i.e. of justifying inductive inference. If you answer this problem by saying that what is called an inductive inference